Wouldn't it be nice to have several thought leaders in your industry know and love your brand? Start a podcast. Invite your industry's thought leaders to be guests on your show and start reaping the benefits of having a network full of industry influencers. Learn more at sweetfishmedia.com.
You're listening to the B2B Growth Show, a podcast dedicated to helping B2B executives achieve explosive growth. Whether you're looking for techniques and strategies or tools and resources, you've come to the right place. I'm Jonathan Green.
And I'm James Carberry.
Let's get into the show.
Welcome back. We are here today with Samantha Stone. She is the founder and CMO at the Marketing Advisory Network. Samantha, how are you doing today?
Oh, it's great. I love starting my week off by chatting with you.
Yeah. This has been fantastic. So today we are going to be talking about using persona insights to really drive your editorial calendar. And so before we get into that, though, Samantha, could you just explain a little bit about the Marketing Advisory Network and what you guys are up to over there?
Absolutely. Love to do that. Marketing Advisory Network is a strategic marketing consulting company. We work with companies who sell complex products and services. That's really what we specialize in. And we help them develop content strategies. We do a lot of work with sales and marketing integration and getting those things aligned. One of the things that we're spending a lot of time on this year actually is around helping people roll out their first account-based marketing programs, something that we're seeing more and more interest in. So I've been having a lot of fun helping companies build pilots and experiments so they can really understand how it might impact their business.
Love it. I love it, Samantha. We're looking at podcasting as a ABM play as well. So we're doing the same thing on our side. So Samantha, as we kind of dive into this, we're going to be looking at kind of how can we use persona insights to drive our editorial calendar. This first question that I wanted to talk to you about is, what information can we provide authors to kind of better match content to audience?
I'm so glad you asked that, because one of the things that I'm seeing increasing is, it used to be we had very small numbers of writers, right? We had trained writers and editors, and we would pick a couple people in our organization and they would write everything. And thankfully, content marketing has changed that as a discipline. And we have more and more people who are contributing to blog posts and white papers and podcasts and all these different kinds of content formats. The challenge is, a lot of the people that we are asking to create content are actually not authors and writers by trade or by discipline or training. And so we have to do a better job of helping give them guidance and direction to get what we want. And one of the things that typically happens is we go, here, I want you to write about this topic. It's due on March 3rd. You have 1,200 words and it's for IT managers. Go.
Got it.
Right? Yeah. And those are important pieces of information we need to give people, but it's wholly inefficient for someone to actually go off and create quality content that's going to actually engage an audience in a meaningful way. And so we need to train them to understand, not it's for IT managers, that's not very helpful. It's for IT managers who have this type of problem and are thinking about solving it in these ways. And we have to train them on our personas, and we have to train them on our audience. And we have to do one other thing that I find almost no one does, which is we have to give them specific direction on what we want the reader to do after they've read it.
Okay.
And this is really important, because we give them direction on the topic, but not the action. Do we want someone to leave this and go take a demo? Do we want someone to read this and think, having thought about their problem in a different way? Do we want them to read it and be self-assessing? Do I have this problem? When we fail to give that direction, what happens is we often create things that are sort of what I call least common denominator, right? They sort of appeal sort of to a lot of people, but not really to anybody. And we're not writing to write, we're writing to spur action. And we have to do a much better job at helping those people who are creating that content be able to encourage that type of action.
That makes perfect sense, Samantha. I'm glad that you said that, because as organizations are becoming more and more sophisticated in the way they're doing content marketing, they're bringing in outside. They're not just bringing in people that are traditional writers anymore. And so having that insight to say, hey, we like, you need to be more specific whenever you're telling this person that does not write for a living to create this piece of content. The more direction you give them, the better. And that's phenomenal advice. So this next thing that I want to talk to you about, Samantha, you know, is like personas, they're great, but how do they actually inform kind of the day-to-day editorial calendar?
That's a really good question. And it's something that I struggled with a few years ago, I'll be honest. A few years ago, I did a ton of persona research, and I never asked about content. And how silly was that? Yeah. I've got the people that I'm trying to move through a buying process on the phone for 45 minutes or an hour, or sometimes in person with me, and I'm asking all these deep questions about their fears and their motivations and how they buy. And I wasn't putting anything in front of them to help inform my editorial calendar, and it was a really lost opportunity. So one of the things that I've done to help change that is at the end of every discussion, I present a list of headlines.
Okay.
It could be anything. Does nothing more than a headline. And it's usually 12 or 15 headlines, and there are various types of topics and various types of tones. And I actually ask them to rate each one of them on a scale of 1 to 5. 1 means I have zero, like, I wouldn't even like register that I read that headline. It'd mean nothing to me. And 5 is, I would drop what I'm doing to read this. Like, that would be really, really compelling to me. And I'm doing this not because there's this magical list of topics that's suddenly going to capture their attention. I'm doing this to find patterns. And I'm always surprised by how different personas go through the same list and answer it differently. And I get cues on the topics that are most compelling to them, but probably more importantly, the tone. Because I may, in that, I usually have the same topic brought up in maybe 3 different ways. One's more negative, one's more positive, one's more how-to, right? And I play with that, and I see what that person is drawn to. And you'll be surprised how many patterns actually exist. So that's one of the ways that I use personas to inform my sort of day-to-day editorial calendar.
I love it. That's like a super practical execution of like, how do you, like, what do we actually do on these calls? We talked to Adele Ravella in another session, and so she is huge on doing these calls, like putting in the work. It's not sending out a survey. It's not like just talking to your sales team. It's actually getting on the phone with people. And that's such an incredible like exercise to go through whenever you have someone, that you've just asked all these deep questions to, getting those, like running those 10 to 15 headlines by them while they're already talking to you. That's brilliant. So how important is it, Samantha, to break down your editorial calendar by audience?
Oh, there's really no other way to do it.
Okay.
So, and we talked a little bit about this, and we talked about how do you arm authors with insights to write valuable, engaging content. And we're so caught up with, I have to create a lot of stuff, right? So we do things like we map the buyer's journey, and we spend a lot of time talking about what process our buyers go through, and we try and understand what questions they want answered in each of those stages. But if we don't build our editorial calendar around how different personas and different audiences need and interact with that information at different stages, we don't have the resonance we need with their audience. And I'll just give you an example of something that it was a client of mine. They're actually doing phenomenal work of personas. They told me recently when I went to visit them a couple days ago, they had their big sales kickoff and their sales team actually dressed up as their personas. It was great. I loved that they were bringing these things to life, and
yeah,
they do a lot of things like that, which is great. But one of the things that they've done correctly is they look at the content that they're creating and they break it down who's it for, and they avoid the temptation to try and create the same piece for lots of different people. And one of the reasons we've done that is they have a really important influential buyer. We call him Oliver. And Oliver is an executive. And I won't go into detail about what his persona is, but I will tell you that he is impatient. He is critical to the buying process, but only in 2 stages. And he has very specific ideas about how he likes information shared with him. And we've uncovered that. We've validated that. The team previously had been sending everything to Oliver because Oliver was so critical to the buying process. He triggered it and he approved it. The problem was Oliver was getting really annoyed because everything in between that was just literally like a gnat buzzing in his ear. And it was actually turning him off. And so we were having the opposite effect of what we wanted to be doing. So we have to figure out and break down our content by who it's going to. And the last thing about that I just want to make sure we keep in mind is that we don't always have to create totally different content for different people. We actually can use an incredible amount. Sometimes it's changing the abstract, changing the title. And the same core content actually will work for a different audience. But we need to make sure that we're putting in a position, or maybe it's just telling one different story, or maybe the example that we put in about this topic, we switch out for one person versus another. So we don't have to wholesale always recreate every bit of content for every different person, but we do have to be thinking about it as it is for someone, right? It's not for a title. It's not for a function. It's for a person. They're going to read this stuff. Let's make sure it's written for that person.
No, I love that. I love that, Samantha. So when would you say is it appropriate to include external readers kind of in the review process of this content that we're putting out that's like hyper-contextual to a very specific human?
Always. Okay. And this is a step that I think we all skip over, right? Because, yeah. Oh, it's just a blog post, or, oh, it's just a presentation for this group. And it's very easy to not take that extra step to do the review. We do lots of internal reviews, right? I don't know about you, but most of my clients and myself, I have like six people who review every piece of content that goes out. But not in almost no cases are they the people the content is designed for. So I'll give you, I'm creating a presentation I'm doing for a seminar on account-based marketing and how to execute it. And I am fairly comfortable with the content, but I took that presentation. There was a marketer I know who was rolling out their program. I'm not helping them with it. I just happen to know they're working on it. I said, okay, blindly read this. Look at this. What did I miss? Does it cover the things that are important to you? And you know what? With a sample size of one, they made it better. And they helped me. I inserted a whole nother little section that I had overlooked. I hadn't even considered putting in there, but it was questions. And as soon as she said it to me, I go, you're right. That I get asked that all the time. I absolutely should include that detail. So we need to include people. Now, we don't have to – that doesn't mean that you have to put in place 6 weeks of reviews and 50 people – but review it by somebody, right? Yeah.
And not just somebody, the person that's actually geared to help.
That is
such good advice, Samantha, that I don't know that I've ever heard anyone actually offer that up. It makes so much sense. I know we don't do that. And the upside, not only is the content going to be better, but the more you talk about like ABM and targeted accounts, and it's this one-to-one relationship with these ideal buyers, what a better way, like a prospect that you're nurturing, what a better way to go to them and say, hey, our team just finished up this blog post. I'd love to get your thoughts on it. It's meant for, you know, the COO, you're a COO, you know, I'd love to get your feedback on it. It's a non-intrusive. It's, hey, we're stroking your ego. We want your thoughts. Plus it's going to make the content better. So
it makes the content better. And I'll tell you, people like being asked.
Exactly.
Every once in a while, someone will say, oh, I'm really too busy. I can't do that. Okay. I totally understand. But you know what? They want to participate. They want content that actually resonates with them. So they are willing to look, and at least in your long form content, at least in the things that you invest significant amounts of energy in creating, it's really a necessary step.
I love it. I love it. Samantha, this has been incredible, super actionable advice. If there's somebody, maybe they want to pick your brain more on this and they want to learn more about the Marketing Advisor Network, or they just want to connect with you, Samantha, what's the best way for them to go about doing that?
Excellent. So they can go to marketingadvisorynetwork.com. I know it's a mouthful, but then they can do that. I'm also on Twitter at Samantha Stone. I'm on LinkedIn. So lots of ways to get a hold of me. And I always welcome questions. So anybody thinking about this, wants to sort of pass an idea, wants another person to take a look at some content, feel free to send it over. I'm happy to always return the favor.
Awesome. Awesome, Samantha. Well, again, thank you so much for your time today. This has been fantastic. So I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
To ensure that you never miss an episode of the B2B Growth Show, subscribe to the show on iTunes or your favorite podcast player. This guarantees that every episode will get delivered directly to your device.
If you or someone you know would be an incredible guest for the B2B Growth Show, email me at jonathan@sweetfishmedia.com. Let us know. We love connecting with B2B executives, and we love sharing their wisdom and perspective with our audience.
Thank you so much for listening. Until next time.